After having so much fun making the last Top 10 Shiny video, I figured I would do another. As I said previously, I love shiny Pokemon, and while I'm not a hardcore hunter, I do have over 20. And like 90% came from my copy of X. For a recap, shinies are Pokemon that have different color palettes and nothing else and are rare as hell. This time, my list will be run more by my emotions rather than logic. I mean, it is a video about opinions after all, and half of the shinies on this list are ones I actually went through the trouble of getting. I'm not going to boast about color theory too much in this one. Again, a lot of this list is more about my own preference rather than what hues might mesh well based on fact. There are some Kalos Pokemon that I already covered in my Alolan Shiny video, since the Pokédexes overlap, and I had no idea if I'd ever be making another one of these. That being said, this time I'm only putting Kalos-specific Shinies on this list to allow for future video possibilities, and Legendaries are disqualified too because they would take up almost half the list. Alright, no more stalling, let's get into it! Starting out strong at number 10, we've got Go-Goat. If anything has been learned about my opinions from my previous video, I'm a sucker for palettes that prominently feature black and white. Darkest shade to black, lightest shade to white, easy stuff. They shifted the green from a deep forest green towards yellow, giving us chartreuse. And notice anything else y'all about this? Those horns! Changing the horns from black to gold makes it look regal and commanding, like a legendary creature. In fact, there is a legend, a Sylvanian folktale about Golden Horn. A chamois buck that lived in Mount Triglav that was so beautiful it was almost killed because of a desperate hunter trying to prove himself to some flighty bra, but then it was healed and became super powerful from some magic flowers and then knocked a hunter off a cliff. Okay, that was a bit of a tangent, but regardless, the gold does look amazing. Not enough for it to blind me in its glory and fall off a mountain, but enough for a spot on this list. At number 9, Greninja. I personally think Greninja is kind of overrated. It's a bitch to deal with in competitive battling, and that Ash Greninja thing just... I'm not even gonna touch that. But its shiny lends itself perfectly to its legacy and goes full ninja. The white and turquoise spots pop against the black, and I actually like the tongue better as dark red. Being less of a fleshy color lets me forget that it's actually just a giant, disgusting tongue wrapping around his head. Nothing much else to say about this one. You do you, Greninja. On to number 8, we've got Meowstic. I'm gonna be quick with this one. I like Meowstic because it looks like pudding. Seriously. I don't have any big reason spawned from fancy color wheel trivia. I just saw the shiny before the game even came out and ended up playing through the whole thing, just thinking about the beautiful moment when I'd have this newfangled shiny charm thing and had a shot at this precious little cupcake. Just from one look, I knew that if it was male, I would name it Custard, and if it was female, I'd name it, well, Pudding. And that's what I did. Normally, I don't like Pokemon that they just add some yellow to, but this specific banana yellow they used is really mellow and soft, and the eyes work even better now because of those beloved analogous colors. For number 7, Pumpkaboo. Look at this cute little Pumpkaboo, oh my god, you're so precious! Pumpkaboo and Gorgeist are obviously based on jack-o'-lanterns. They're pumpkins with faces, and they're the only Pokemon to learn a move called Trick or Treat. So naturally, they should have Halloween colors, right? The original colors kind of got that down. The orange is a little pale for a pumpkin, but it works just fine. Normally, when you think of Halloween, the colors that come to mind are black and orange, but the holiday is actually also commonly associated with bright green and purple. And keeping the yellow works twofold, being both, obviously by now, the complement to purple and still looking like light glowing through a jack-o'-lantern's carvings. At number 6, Slurpuff. This is quite the derpy looking Pokemon, isn't it? It's based off of a meringue and a pug. Both Slurpuff and Swirlix are entirely composed of pink shades looking like cotton candy. It won't even evolve until you present it with a specific dessert. So the shiny just took it to the extreme and made the Pokemon itself a dessert. I mean, look at it! It looks like jam, sandwiched between two layers of cake, iced with chocolate and topped with a bright red berry. God, I'm just hungry now. And number 5, people are going to disagree with me on this one. It's Hawlucha. They really threw everything out the door for this shiny. I mean, what were they thinking? Whatever it was, I love it. For all my talk of color theory and how colors work together, you'd assume I wouldn't like this. The deep red and soft purple do look nice together, and I love it when they add black to shinies because it feels more intense and dramatic, but that green? Maybe if they had made it more of a bluish green, it would fit, but No, it's this weird lime color that does not mesh at all. It's not a complementary palette, it's not analogous, and it doesn't really fit into either the warm or cold side of the color wheel. Trust me, I hate it when I can't explain why I like something, and that's even the whole point of these videos, is to explain. The most I can say for it is just that it's such an unexpected shiny that it just really caught my eye. Also, I give it some slack for being based on a Lucha Libre. Have you seen some of the color combinations on those guys? You can't say it's not an accurate representation of those crazy costumes, and you also can't say it's not a super memorable shiny for just how out of the box it is. Number 4, Chestnut. Well, would you look at that, another starter. While people were losing their shit over their wizard foxes and ninja frogs, I adored this juggernaut since day one. People liked Chespin okay, but freaked when they saw that the palette changed dramatically as Chestnut, which, might I just add, this change of colors actually totally does make sense for it being a chestnut that has ripened. Anyway, its shiny is what we thought we were going to get. Its entire palette is earthy tones, creamy tan, a nice reddish brown, and pistachio green. To keep it from being dull, it has a stripe of rich orange to replace the red. Even that shade of orange is earthy when you think about it. Autumn leaves, sandstone. Yeah, sandstone isn't really applicable to this Pokemon, but just like how humans enjoy the sights of analogous colors and complementary colors, we are also drawn towards colors that are found in nature. And the colors of nature are definitely bursting from Chestnut's palette. Coming in at number 3, we've got Aromatisse. This one is similar to Sylveon in that it's basically just a color swap. The purple and magenta switch places, big whoop. But also like Sylveon, the colors already worked well together, so therefore, they still look good here. And I actually think this looks better than the original. The original just felt off balance. Lightest, darkest, middle tone? Nah, get your visual hierarchy right, kids. I even like the change of the eyes to yellow because now it matches the markings on the... Are those ears? It matches the yellow markings, unifying the composition as a whole. This Pokemon also holds a special place in my heart as I told myself I'd give up on the 1050th egg, and guess what popped out at 1049. Let's go to number 2 with... Clodsir. It's a lobster with a laser cannon. What does the shiny do? Makes it a cooked lobster. I promise I didn't just write this when I was hungry. Blue and red are both primary colors, so they have a certain punch to them, but red even more so than blue. The original does make sense since it's a water type and live lobsters can actually be blue, but it's a subdued color. It's passive and calm, it represents sorrow and innocence. Red, on the other hand, is aggressive and passionate. It represents anger and ferocity. I always feel like my shiny Clodsir will hit harder than my normal one, even if their stats are pretty much identical. And of course, brightening the yellow to white is good in my book. And for number 1... Florges. It was so hard to figure out exactly what number 1 should be, but it just had to be Florges. Why? Because every time I try to think of what my all-time favorite Pokemon is out of the entire 700 plus roster, it's always Florges. I don't know why, I love it. Florges is pretty much a fairy that fused with a bouquet, so it comes in 5 different flower colors, so they needed to create a shiny that would fit with each one. What was the answer? Purple. Both green and purple are secondary colors. You have to mix 2 different primaries to get them. Therefore, at the right tone, green and purple could fit with almost anything for being either analogous or complementary, and can work for either a cool or warm palette based on its surrounding colors. Something so simple could have gone so wrong had they not picked this perfect shade of purple. Florges rhymes with gorgeous for a reason. And voila, my top 10 favorite shinies from the Kalos region. I'm sorry this was less informative than my last list, but really, sometimes you just gotta go with your gut. Does that make me a hypocrite? Maybe. But I still stand by all of my choices. Anyway, here's the obligatory end card where I beg you to share this with your friends, leave a like, and subscribe, because I might actually continue to make videos if enough people find my intrinsically worthless opinions interesting. See you next time.